Welcome to TalkNorth.com. Thanks to our longtime producer, Brandon Morton. Please download before you listen. If you'd like to advertise with us, you can reach us at TalkNorthPodcast@gmail.com. And please follow us on Twitter at TalkNorthPod. Two promo codes to be aware of. Bitesquad.com, use the promo code TalkNorth to get your first delivery free. And go to SodaStick.com, the great local apparel company. Use the promo code YouBetcha to get free shipping on any sized order. Kendricks was willing to restructure his deal. We're going to talk to Jeff about what that means for the rest of the roster, what that means for Kyle Rudolph. Jeff's also going to go through some of the more difficult negotiations he had to deal with when he was general manager of the Vikings. Of course, he was also the NFL executive of the year, and he also was the president of the Tennessee Titans when they went to the Super Bowl. So he has great insights into how this all works. Thanks to WhiteBearLakeSuperstore.com for sponsoring the program. I'm Jim Suhan, and this is part of the TalkNorth.com podcast network. So let's just start with the news. Bradbury signs. What does that mean for the Vikings right now?
Yeah, well, I think it's important because you get your first-round draft pick signed, and basically their entire draft class is signed except maybe one or two guys. But the key thing is getting the first-rounder in and signed is important. And then he doesn't have to worry about it. He can focus in on learning the offense and trying to figure out if he's going to be a center or a guard. And the fact that they're counting on this guy to start this year, there's no doubt that he has to start this year for this football team. And based on that, get the contract done and get him in the right frame of mind where he's not thinking about that. And I think that's a good thing with a young guy, that he can focus in on the task at hand, which is learning the offense and getting in sync with the rest of the offensive linemen and with what Rick Dennison, the offensive line coach, wants him to do in this new outside zone scheme offense. So I think it's a good thing. And fortunately, they had Eric Kendricks willing to restructure, which any player would be willing to restructure, because when you restructure a contract, all you're doing is converting some of your base salary to signing bonus, which becomes guaranteed. And so it's advantageous to the player to restructure all in any case, unless it's a kind of a restructure that Everson Griffin did, which was actually a pay cut. So that's a different deal that he restructured with a lesser salary and an opportunity to get out of his contract next year. If he has, I think it's 6 sacks or something, he can opt out. And so in this case, it was just probably a straight restructure, free up $1 million or $2 million or whatever that they needed to get Bradbury signed. And I think what people have to understand at this stage of the game, and people think, oh, does that mean that Kyle Rudolph doesn't have to get traded or doesn't have to take a salary reduction or doesn't have to restructure or extend? No, they still need help. Because the difficulty is right now only the top 51 salaries count under the salary cap. And when you go to the final roster in September, then every player counts, the 53-man roster, plus injured reserve, which is usually 5 or 6 guys, plus a practice squad of 8 to 10 players. And you want to have a little bit of extra room to sign a player if you need one, if somebody gets hurt during the season. And so... And also perhaps to pay some incentives. So they still need to free up several million dollars, and which leads us back to Kyle Rudolph being the logical candidate to get that done. And whether that's in an extension for him, he's going into his last year, they'd have to extend him out a year or two and then take the risk on having some dead money down the road if they end up cutting him or trading him later. But I think they do want him on the roster this year, but they want that salary reduced. Or in an extension, knock down the cap number. But I think they're looking for a reduction, period, based on what they anticipate his production to be compared to a $7.6 million salary and with Irv Smith Jr. coming in. So there's still work to be done for Rick Spielman and Rob Brzezinski, definitely.
What was the trickiest negotiation you ever had? Because, you know, we talked about it on the Viking Update show before this deal was done. You know, Rudolph and Zimmer both out of that charity golf tournament and both saying, oh, it's business. And neither of them sounding particularly enthusiastic about this. So here you have a guy who's been very classy, who's been good, he's been productive, who wants to stay here. And you have the Vikings saying, that's all great, but the numbers got to be right. Did you have those kind of experiences?
Oh, yeah. And we hadn't. In the, a lot of the years I was negotiating contracts, the salary cap was extremely tight for us because we only experienced maybe in many years a $1 million or $2 million increase in the cap. Maybe it was going from 67 to 68 or something. Well, now it's 180 million or 185 million, and it's been going up 10 million a year. Now, be that as it may, the Vikings still have gotten jammed up on the cap because of the Cousins contract and because of doing the bar deal and of course all the other veteran players that they've signed, the Daniil Hunters, the Adam Thielens, the Stephon Diggs and Kendricks for one, and so you've got a number of guys that are commanding pretty significant salaries, Harrison Smith still, and of course, as we mentioned, Everson Griffin on his deal. So Kyle Rudolph is the guy that is kind of in the crosshairs right now. And Griffin was earlier this year. Now it's Rudolph, and so we'll see how it plays out. But yeah, I had several experiences where we were very tight on the cap, and I remember back probably about 1994 or so. Excuse me, and we had basically Terry Allen was our starting running back, and Robert Smith we had drafted the year before. He'd been hurt, but he was projected to be kind of share time with Terry Allen. And so I went into a negotiation with Terry, who ostensibly was still our starting running back, even though Robert Smith was projected to kind of knock him out of the box eventually, but they were going to split time. And so had to go to, we were very tight on the cap, and I had to go to Terry and ask him to take a pay cut, but build it back up with incentives is what usually happens. That, if you play and you play more, Robert Smith, if he gets hurt again, you end up playing more, you'll get more in incentives. We can build you back up. And what wound up happening was we eventually ended up releasing Terry, I think a year later, but we got a grievance filed against us by the Players Association with Terry and his agent, and where they claimed that we didn't have to cut him for salary cap purposes and there was no reason we had to. So I had to have documentation showing how tight we were on the cap, which fortunately I had and was able to prove the case, and we won the case. But it was tough, and it was tough to be in that room, a grievance hearing with Terry and his wife. I really like Terry Allen. He's a class guy, great guy. And I think that, and actually we talked afterwards, and everything was cool, and because I think he knew that how tight we were on the cap, and we were trying to do the right thing, and he was trying to make sure that we were telling the truth that we needed the salary cap room. So, but I had a lot of other tough negotiations over the years with players, and in a tight cap situation, and just other crazy negotiations that we had. I had negotiations. For example, with one of the classic ones I always talk about when I give my speeches about negotiation is the Chris Dolman case, where I signed Chris back basically 2 years before free agency started, early 90s, and made him equal to Reggie White and Bruce Smith as the highest paid defensive end in the league. It was about $2 million a year at that time. Today he'd be making about 22 or 24 million a year, but he was a little ahead of his time, and so did that deal with Chris Dolman and his agent David Falk, who was a big NBA agent at the time, represented Michael Jordan, Patrick Ewing, and I remember going to Washington, D.C. and sitting with David, and he's talking about Michael Jordan for about 2 hours and trying to intimidate me mm-hmm. as a young negotiator doing my first big deal. And so I said, David, I love Michael Jordan as much as anybody, but let's talk about Chris. So we finally got Chris's deal done and gave him a nice signing bonus. And David Falk says, you won't hear from us for 5 years. Well, 2 years later, free agency comes to the NFL, and Reggie White signs for $4.5 million a year in Green Bay, more than twice what Chris was making. And, of course, the first call I get is from David Falk saying, Chris can't play under this contract. This is crazy. And I said, David, you told me I wouldn't hear from you for 5 years. Well, guess what? 2 years later, and I said, David, play one more year, have Chris play one more year into this contract, get to there's only 2 years left. I can't redo a contract with 3 years remaining, or I'll have every player lined up at the door. And we had a lot of good players in those years, as you know. And so he absolutely refused, and Chris refused to play under that contract, and so ended up having to trade him to Atlanta, I think, for a first and second round pick. At the time, I think he was around 28 or 29 years old, had his best years with us, but still had a number of other great years remaining that he played in Atlanta and San Francisco, and of course became a Hall of Famer. And it just was one of those deals where, due to circumstances beyond your control, sometimes those things happen. So, yeah, I've experienced all kinds of tough negotiations, difficult ones, and that was one for sure. And I had another one with Gary Zimmerman, who had signed an extension, never played a down under the contract, and Kirk Loudermilk, his roommate with the Vikings, our starting center, goes to Indianapolis for double what Gary was going to make as the best left tackle in football because of free agency starting in the NFL. And, of course, Zim unfortunately refused to play under the contract, too, and had to trade him to Denver for, I think it was a first, second, and sixth round pick. I didn't want to lose Gary Zimmerman. I didn't want to lose Chris Dolman. But we were stuck, unfortunately, on those deals, and that happens.
Let's thank WhiteBearLakeSuperstore.com before we finish this conversation and talk about Odell Beckham and some other stuff around the league. WhiteBearLakeSuperstore.com, they are now having their spring sales event. Get up 18% below MSRP or 0% APR for 72 months.
Yeah, Jim, definitely White Bear Lake Superstore, Buick GMC, a great dealership, and I'm always excited to talk about White Bear Lake Superstore. My longtime friend, the owner Paul Rubin, his general manager Charlie Gattrell, and their great staff are Minnesota's number one volume Buick GMC dealer, 5 years running, with the best selection and the only place to get the premium experience. And as you said, the sale is going on now, and all kinds of great deals on the website at WhiteBearLakeSuperstore.com. There's a 2019 Buick Enclave with a $2,000 purchase bonus cash, a 2019 Buick Enclave with 0% APR for 60 months and a $500 cash allowance, and a 2019 Buick Encore with a cash allowance deal. Great pre-owned specials on the website, so check it out. Superstore Buick GMC is also the Quigley 4x4 Van Superstore, and they are a certified elite dealer. Only 7% of GM dealers make the cut, so visit in person at 3900 Highway 61 North in White Bear Lake or online at WhiteBearLakeSuperstore.com for all your vehicle needs and the premium experience. Buick GMC, we are professional grade.
Before we move on to other topics, I'll just offer this. Let's say you are appointed arbitrator. I know this isn't going to happen. This is hypothetical, theoretical. But let's say somebody appointed you arbitrator to walk in, sit down with let's say, Rick Spielman, Rob Brzezinski, Kyle Rudolph, and his agent. And they just said, okay, we're putting our faith in you. Make a deal that'll make both of us happy. What would you do?
Well, I think what I would try to do is essentially take that $7.6 million salary he's supposed to get this year, and I would try to extend him one more year and convert a good chunk of that salary to a signing bonus, and then take the risk on next year having a little bit of a dead money hit on it, but also in return for giving him that guarantee that's probably more money than he can make elsewhere, perhaps, then I would build it up with incentives that if he had 64 catches last year, if he has 65 catches, it's a significant amount of money. If he's a Pro Bowl player, significant bonus, and try to tie it to team performance too, which I always try to do with incentives. So I think that would be the way to go. But I think from Kyle's camp, does he think that if he basically says I'm not going to take any kind of pay cut, any kind of reduction, and forces the Vikings to trade him, is another team going to pick up that $7.6 million salary this year? Perhaps they will. And so, because there is no dead money hit on it or whatever, and so that could be another option too for Kyle and his agent. But I know he likes living here. He likes playing for the team, and so to me, doing a 1 year extension and spreading the bonus out a little bit, and then you may have to take a dead money hit next year a little bit, but But hey, it's not going to be the kind of dead money hit the Giants took on Odell Beckham for whatever, 16 to 18 million, or the Steelers took a $21 million dead money hit on Antonio Brown. So worse things can happen. And I think they'd like to have him here at least one more year.